You know, this is a little ironic when I was asked to do an entrepreneur lecture about stopping poachers, because in dealing with these individuals, from the guy in the field with the gun through the criminal syndicates to the transportation links to the merchandising and marketing people in Asia, these are truly the most entrepreneurial people in the world. So perhaps next year you could bring some poachers in here to talk about what they do. Just as an example, rhino porn, and that's what we'll be looking at today, but that's not the only issue we're looking at here. Rhino porn is now being touted in Vietnam as a poor man's or a rich man's Viagra. It cures hangovers. And in the past 2 years, there has been a tremendous marketing push in Vietnam that rhino porn cures cancer. And so what we're finding there is people are going to these clinics and buying a very expensive $10,000 glass of cognac and having a rhino horn, which is nothing more than your fingernails, it's keratin, ground into their drinks. And that's why, you'll see this in a minute, a rhino horn in Vietnam is now worth $500,000. And what we found is these entrepreneurs in Somalia, Sudan, Mozambique, who have been hijacking ships and holding them for ransom, have figured out there's a much easier, faster, cheaper way to make a lot of money. And that is by killing animals, in this case, elephants and rhinos, and shipping them to Asia and reaping 10,000% returns on their initial investments. So I think we can begin by asserting that the current model of trying to stop these guys is not working, and a new paradigm is needed. And what I always try to do when I think about this is, the most important book that I've ever read about science is Winnie the Pooh. And I just, after this debacle here on my iPad, this book is especially appropriate. Kill anyone. And, I would have a call if anyone was here right now, because we're going to ask somebody. When we're looking at trying to deal with these functions in animals in Africa, I can't save every one of them. The scope is too big. But we can take some steps to mitigate the problem. This is a picture of Mugabe the elephant. This was taken at Tsavo National Park when my wife and I were there last September. 2 weeks after this, 11 members of his herd were killed, including 3 females. Tsavo in southern Kenya is a hotbed of Somali poachers who are coming in there and decimating the wildlife. Here are the basic stats. Last year, 30,000 elephants, 668 rhinos were killed in South Africa. So far, 210 this year. 3 were killed last night. You can see why. Tusks in Asia and China go for $125,000 a pair. Rhino horn, about $500,000. The Chinese, the way they do this is they all want to have carved tusks with village scenes and little carvings on their mantles to show that they're rich. I already told you Vietnam. The cancer, the hangovers, and just to show people you're a big shot and that you have a lot of money. This is the rhino you saw on the poster. We took this picture in Lewa in Kenya in late October last year. That horn that you see up there is a magnificent piece. That's worth about $700,000. And then there's a smaller horn here. This is what the Yemenis always use for their handles of their knives. This horn, unfortunately, she was killed, and her baby was killed in December. Lewa, in the last month, has lost 11 rhinos. So if you look at worldwide crime on this, this is why people are doing it. It makes business sense. $10 billion a year. And now this isn't just rhinos and elephants, this is rare plants. Reptiles, birds from South America. For some reason, Hollywood stars have recently taken an affinity to wild African cats. And these are about 45-pound civet cats that they're keeping in apartments in New York City. Something bad is going to happen with that. And finally, I promise I would get it in here. Justin Bieber got his monkey confiscated. Justin Bieber's monkey was confiscated in Germany last week. He didn't have the proper papers. Justin is now traveling the world with a capuchin monkey. Now, if he wants to have a monkey, that's fine. Unfortunately, there are probably thousands of his followers who now think, well, if Justin has a monkey, I should have one too. And I can tell you one clear conclusion that will happen to Justin and that monkey is sooner or later that monkey will wipe his face, because that's what monkeys do. And yet 1,000 young women will go out this year and try and buy monkeys because they want to be like Justin Bieber. So the key issues is, what technology do we use in Africa to combat these poachers? It's got to be appropriate. And I have four criteria here that I think are the key. Number one, it's got to be affordable. There's not a lot of money there to do this. As you know, the World Wildlife Federation is trying to do this right now. They have a $5 million grant from Google to fly drones in Africa. They are trying to fly these behemoths, 20-foot wide catapult-launched planes that I can guarantee you will break after the first time they use it. It's got to be exportable and importable. In the United States, we had to get export control licenses to ship the drones overseas. So we had to jump through a lot of hoops with the State Department and the Defense Department and the Commerce Department to get it out the door. We had to dumb down our cameras and dumb down the autopilots to meet U.S. export licenses. It's got to be importable. I'm going to be telling you in a few minutes about our project in South Africa. We have had to get approval from the South African Ministry of Security, the National Parks, the Air Force, the Civil Aviation Authority, and the Prime Minister's Office. And so unless you get all this paperwork done, you cannot get the equipment into the country. It's got to be easy to maintain. We're going to be there flying for 10 days, 2 weeks, and they're going to leave the drones with the wardens and the rangers. If they don't know how to operate it and maintain it, they have a very expensive piece of yard equipment that's going to sit in front of a lodge and never do anything. So affordable, exportable, easy to maintain, simple to use. I can teach you to fly these drones in 4 hours. And in 8 hours, I can tell you how to tear it apart and put it back together again. So in Washington, we all love acronyms. So I figured if I'm going to give a talk, I've got to invent an acronym. So I did it called STOP. Satellite imagery, technical analysis, operational drones equal prevention of poaching. What we're doing is using satellite imagery at half meters, that's the size of home plate at a baseball stadium. Some sophisticated algorithms that VS knows what to do about. Then small operational drones with very precise flight paths, because Africa's too big for you to be flying around. And we're using FLIR-equipped UAVs with night vision to be able to patrol and intercept poachers before they get to an animal. The key elements, Africa is so big. When people talk about going and launching drones in Africa and say they're going to randomly put them up and fly around, clarify anything. Africa's way, way too big. The animals are too dispersed. The poachers are too dispersed. What we've done is developed a heuristic model where we determine where events are likely to happen. And this allows us to create very specific flight paths for the drone. And at the same time, this allows us to pre-position our rangers between the poachers and the animals. Before we get into a big discussion of the UAVs and drones and civil rights and privacy, these drones are only a tool for us. They're part of our solution set, along with the imagery and the analysis. As I said, I like to use quotes. This is from Sir Fred Hoyle. Who knows what Sir Fred Hoyle is famous for? If anybody gets it, they get a satellite picture of Tsavo National Park. And?
British.
British. That's half credit, man. I can't even. He was the man who invented the words of Big Bang Theory. He was the first
one.
What? Okay. Yeah. He didn't raise his hand, so we're and I'm tempted to be the British, but we've got to do a little better than that. I mean, we use, for the past 8 years, I've been an advisor to GOI, which is now Digital Globe, fly a constellation of 5 satellites. We use primarily data from GOI 1. This is a satellite that gives, as I said, half meter resolution. We can see rhinos, elephants, people from space. It's very accurate to geotag events. Starting in June, we're going to be giving rangers cameras, so when they see a poaching event, they can tag it, and we can load it up, and the accuracy on our satellite data is within 6 feet. So we'll have a very precise model of where poaching events occur. And one of the things we just recently learned in looking at this data is we can identify footpaths, both for the animals and the poachers. And we're overlaying that on our data. And so we're able to look at past poaching events and backtrack and find out where these guys are coming from. We also have 14 years of imagery in the archives, which is very useful in terms of looking at encroachment of villages into the national parks, because that's where a lot of the poaching is taking place. I said that the picture of the rhino we took was from Lewa. This is what a lot of you know satellite data. This is what it looks like when it comes out from the satellite. And what we do is, if you look at one of those green boxes, we then take it and drill down so we can get an area there that we use for our modeling analysis. This is Rusaba National Park in Kenya. Tremendous problems, as I said, with elephant and rhino poaching. The Kenyan government does not give us permission to fly in Kenya for a lot of reasons. And so we're going to South Africa instead. But you can see here, this is the road that goes to Somalia. If we were flying drones in Sabo, and the rhinos are usually in this area here, we would be flying flight paths here, here, have a one drone, fly four drones at a time, have one up over the rhinos, and I'll have to keep one on the back door just in case. So we think that with looking at the heuristic model and determining the time, dates, when these poachers are coming in for the kills, we can set up intercept zones right here before we get to the animals. This is my favorite quote of all time. You can't fight a six-year-old, you don't understand it. What geospatial predictive analysis is simply statistically looking at an environment and comparing it with other previous systems. And then we identify areas where we believe there will be the increased likelihood of a future event. What is interesting is in doing the modeling of Sabo is we found areas that had been previously undetected, and we said these are areas where we think poaching should occur. And the rangers went out and they looked, and they found rhino carcasses. They didn't know they were there, but the model accurately predicted to look in this region, and when they went back, they found the carcasses of the rhino. This is especially important in that it reduces the amount of area you need to patrol. In an area such as Lewa, which is about 180,000 hectares, they have 10 rangers. And so you have to be able to deploy these guys in a proactive way where you can reduce the area that they have to and put them in the most highly risk deployment areas. We all know this, the human elephant patterns can be assessed. This is something BS has worked on for years. I've recently been working with the folks at Digital Globe as we track the Virginia arsonists, and they were caught a week and a half ago. We used the exact same model for poaching for these arsonists. We looked at areas where it was likely on a Saturday night that these guys would be. The police were deployed into a very small area. There were four police cars in a very, very small area where we had identified three houses that were most likely to be torched that night. They drove right into it, they lit the fire, and were caught. So this model works for arsonists, terrorists, poachers, and it works for people who get group on coupons or anything else. Because what they're doing is looking at your past behavior. Why does Amazon send you a note? Oh, you recently bought this book, you might be interested in this. But they're doing the same thing. They're modeling behavior and attempting to forecast what your future actions are. So this is a very, very well used model. And in Africa, it's fairly simple to use because we don't have a lot of data for this. As I said, one of the biggest problems is trying to teach rangers, or if we go up in northern Kenya into Samburu land, how to teach Samburu warriors to collect data. We've worked with these guys and basically said, listen, work with our rangers and tell me exactly what the conditions were on the day an attack occurred. And if you look at the data they collected, a couple of points come up very clearly. Number one, most poaching occurs on about three nights of the month. Full moon, day before, day after. These aren't some hallways with flashlights, they're using the moon. It happens at a particular hour of the day. And so we'll have our next question for a beautiful poster. What hour of the day, midnight to 1, 1 to 2, does most poaching occur? Anyone?
Midnight.
Midnight, why?
Because the moon might be brightest overhead.
Okay. It's not true. I mean, it's true the moon is white, but it's not that important. Any other guesses?
All right, 9 to 10.
9 to 10, why?
Time during dark to haul the goods back to safety.
You got the poster. Yeah. Most of it actually happens between 7 and 8.
Yeah.
Because then that gives them 10 hours to walk away from the site. And if you're looking at 4 kilometers, 5 kilometers an hour, they can get 40 to 50 kilometers away before you unleash the bloodhounds the next morning for the planes up. So you get a poster. We've also been working with collared elephants to have patterns where we take the collar and we superimpose the collar movements on there to show us where the elephants are. Rhinos don't do well with collars, and so it's very, very difficult to track a rhino that way. There is a NGO in town who will not go, I will not name, who believes that we can track rhinos with ankle bracelets. Now, I've never tried to put an ankle bracelet on. I tried to put one on a gorilla, and that didn't work out very well. But that's another story. And so, again, we have the animals, we have the ranger patterns, we have the poacher patterns, and we get ground intelligence. If you go to these African villages and spread a little money around, you'd be amazed how quickly you can find out about who's doing what to whom and when. So the benefits of this model: pre-deployment, increased likelihood of apprehension, test in the field, and easily replicated for other areas. As I said, we started doing this for Savo. We've taken it to another area, and we're now looking at taking it to the Cameroons, Tanzania, and we've just been contacted by a group called Panthera, if any of you know that. It's the big cat folks. And they've asked us to come and help them develop a program. They want to put 1,000 camera traps in a forest in Indonesia, under the auspices of looking for illegal logging, but they're also helping with tracking poachers there. So we're going to start on that. Shakespeare wanted a horse with wings. Here's ours. This is the Falcon drone that we're using. As you can see, it's a hand launch. It's quite small, about 10 kilograms. It's presently being used by a number of police forces in the west, primarily the western United States. It's got a range of about 10 kilometers, speed 45 knots, and go up to about 65 knots on burst. We're probably going to fly at about 1,200 feet, 1,200 to 1,500 feet. As you can see, it's pretty small. One day training, and the key is you hand launch and you can catch it, and these are coming at night, in a dark night in Africa. We'll be catching them with badminton nets, because that's the most appropriate technology for that. They come in, you turn off the motor, and it can launch the parachute belly, or we'll just catch it and then change the batteries out and put it back up. This is more of the technical package. It is steerable, two axis. We have Earth observation IR cameras. The battery charges in the Jeep. We have a very nice autopilot. The State Department requires us to have an autopilot so we keep track on the computer of where we've flown. And so the State Department does not want us flying in Mozambique and Somalia. It has a round-of-home loss. This is really great. This is what I call a dog whistle. If you lose contact with the drone, it knows the coordinates that you plugged in when you start and it flies back to you. So you won't lose it somewhere out in the bush. It takes 1 minute to assemble, 5 minutes to launch. This is what the police love. They like it for bank robberies, hostage situations, anywhere where they can use a helicopter. These Falcons are about $10,000 compared to $3 million for a helicopter. Live video feed to a laptop, just like your iPad, you can control it out in the field. And then lightweight. And on this one, because we've dumbed it down enough with the autopilot and the cameras, we got a U.S. Department of Commerce license instead of a State Department of ITAR license, which is a very onerous thing. don't want to do that. So if you want to, I knew I was going to have trouble with this thing, which is why I didn't upload videos of the Falcon and embed it in my presentation. If you want to look at it, go to falconuav.com. It has a lovely little snips that are on YouTube of day and night flights. We've been launching at very, very high altitudes. Because you know, Kenya is a high altitude country. You're up about 6,000 feet ground altitude. It has a capacity to lock on to a big vehicle or an individual or a rhino. And it will say in the circle on top of that item that you've asked to lock on. We're using extremely high resolution cameras on this. For our daylight cameras, we can see down to 8 inches. So we're using that to control fence lines to look for breaks and fences. So it's in sum, before I tell you what our action plan is, imagery analysis and drones, I think we can prevent poaching. We're not going to stop everyone, but we are going to create a deterrent effect in Africa, and we are going to have some intercepts. Again, we determine the flight path of the drone to increase the likelihood. People always tell me, Tom, this UAV is too small. It only flies 10 kilometers. My response to that is, if you're flying 100 kilometers away, and you see poachers at night in Africa, how are you going to get them? The range of your drone is only as important as the distance to which you can send your rangers to get an intercept. And so we think by doing the mathematical analysis and modeling, we can reposition our rangers to be very close. When the drone up, we'll be able to pick the poachers up about 2 kilometers away. I'll watch them coming in towards the animals and basically set up an intercept or an ambush. To disarm them and take them out. The good news, we have completed the work at Savo and areas around Kruger. All the modeling is done, and the rental flights have been flight paths have been determined. We have our U.S. license, and we're ready to go. And so now I'm happy to announce publicly for the first time, beginning in late May, we will be flying a constellation of 4 Falcon UAVs at Kruger National Park. This will be the first time that the drones have ever been used at night to combat poachers in Africa. I'm not going to tell you exactly where we're going to be flying or when we're going to be flying, but it will be up near Kruger. As I said, we use 4 drones to make sure that we have 1 over the animals at all times, 2 to control, and we're going to start in 1 reserve and move to 3 other reserves that are adjacent to Kruger National Park. That is the area where they're losing between 3 and 4 rhinos a night. And so we think by looking at those areas, we can get very close and be able to intercept these guys as they come in. Now, just hypothetically, and I'm not saying we're going to fly here, but this happens in a reserve that's directly next to Kruger National Park. This is called Oliphant. You can see the Oliphant River here. You can see here, this is the main Kruger Road. This is Kruger Park to the east, the private reserves to the west. There are fences between there, so the animals can freely move. All of the west is very lucky. They have a very large concentration of rhinos, and they tend to stay right here along this river, up here, usually on the south side. And so if we were hypothetically going to look at flying in this area, you see the other main road you get down here, the main Kruger Road. My guess is since the rhinos are here, they always stay in this area, we would fly our drones here and here and have rangers here for the intercept. And I think you might see something in the Sunday Times of Johannesburg the first weekend of June about where these were flown. So the game changes. We have 15 nights of anti-poaching flights beginning late May. We will fly during the day to identify where the rhinos and elephants are. We're working, I love this, kind of in a jacket. We're working with the black mambas. This is a new anti-poaching unit that's been
created in South Africa, of former special forces in South Africa, and local village leaders. They've also recruited a number of former poachers, and they paid them a lot of money, and I think offered them a ticket out of jail, to work on the other side. And so we have a team there working with all these folks, and I think that the bottom line is the playing field of the poachers is about to be level. Here's something I just want to put on the table for thinking about for the next year. And if there's any entrepreneurial students in here that want to think about this, come and talk to me and we'll get going on this. When you talk to the rangers and to these national park heads in Africa and say, what could you really use besides drones? The answer they always give me is this. Try to develop a tracking device that you would place inside a tusk, not a live elephant, but one that was killed, that we could use to track the tusks in China. If you ask the Chinese today, how many tusks go into China every year, what's the answer? Zero. And so we're looking to put a device that will be in the nerve canal of the dental nerve canal of the rhino. But not the rhino, the elephant, the rhino is too small. That will set up a periodic GPS signal. And you'll be able to track that. What we'll do is we'll get a seized tusk, put the device in, put it back into the marketplace, and watch it as it travels from Mombasa to probably Shanghai. The challenge here is you need battery life. That's the key, you know? And because these tusks are hidden in these big 42-foot containers that are piled up on a ship, there's going to be some problem with the strength signal. We're working with some people who are saying, well, let's put a motion sensor in. So when it's on the high seas and there's movement, it won't turn on. But when you come to a port stop, it will turn on. Maybe that's the solution. So this is a challenge. Any of you, if any of you come up with an idea, present it next year, and whoever wins, we will take it after to we'll put you up in Africa to test this with their elephants. So if someone wants to get on this, put a team together. Next year you can do this, we'll take it Africa and test it out. So the good news is, for the University of Maryland, that is going to be on the bottom of the wings of the drones. If you have any poaching friends in South Africa, the last three words they will ever see on this screen are fair to this is our team members, so thank you very much. We have time for questions here, and I look forward to meeting you.